Hello YouTube, my name is Paul. Hope you're all keeping well. Welcome back to another pickup video. A Spectrum inspired pickup video, if you hadn't guessed already. Got about 15 games to show you through various different publishing houses. Games that I had back in the day. Amazingly, because I thought I had most of the games I had back in the day, but there's a couple of games here I once had. I can't believe I didn't bloody pick them up. But yeah, I mean, it's a couple of games here that I picked up relatively cheap. Got a couple of little bargains here. But yeah, I mean, I love collecting for the Spectrum, as you already know. Problem is, it's such a wide... I don't know, because the Spectrum was around for such a long time, and there's so many games, it's impossible to say they're going to go for a Spectrum set. It's just something that no one... I don't think no one's ever achieved. There's some gigantic collections out there, but bloody hell. So I kind of focused mainly on the commercial games that came out sort of like mid-80s to very early 90s. I got myself kind of stuck into certain subsets, like Ocean Software, for example, or the Hit Squad. But there are many other subsets I like, but under no pressure to pick them up. We're under no illusions that they're going to be quite straightforward to pick up. But yeah, but I'd love to get involved with the kind of earlier stuff. I mean, the kind of bedroom coding stuff, which is probably nowadays called homebrew, isn't it? But yeah, I mean, games that sort of sat at home, I thought, oh, I'll make this game, and then what I'll do is I'll draw myself a cover and then sell it at the local shop or go to a local trade event and try and sell them that way, because there was no distribution network as such in place back in that day. So I can imagine loads of little Dell boys running around creating their own gaming companies. So yeah, that's quite fascinating, but like I said, a lot of the games are not nostalgic at all, and probably grim. But yeah, I know a lot of people love collecting that stuff, and I am interested in it, and I will pick up a few bits here and there, just so we can kind of show what gaming was like back in the day. When I say back in the day, I wouldn't remember it very well, so I was probably about 7 or 8 years old, so for me, it just passed me by. But yeah, let's crack on anyway. So yeah, Spectrum-wise, like I said, about... pushing about 1,000 games now. There's not that many more I want to get. The thing with the Spectrum, you say that, and more stuff comes up because you want it all. So, what we got first? First, a game I played on the Atari ST, and I liked it on the ST. It's a game involving balls. It's a game involving balls you've got to smash together, and that usually means one thing: multiplication. There's emotion. So yeah, I like this on the ST. The fact you can play using a mouse really helped. And you literally have to collide two objects together that look the same and the same color, and they disappear. Or if you don't, and knock them into different shapes and different colors, they multiply and it becomes bloody hard. This game got a follow-up called Vaccine, which don't come up very often. I'm pretty sure it didn't get a Spectrum release. If it did, it's bloody rare. I'm pretty sure it didn't. Yeah, good game. I'd recommend it. It's cheap. The Spectrum version, unfortunately, is in monochrome, which just makes it a little bit more difficult. The controls are more clunky because you're using keyboard or a joystick, and it's not as smooth as the 16-bit version. It just makes it a little bit more difficult to play. Again, it's one of those games where the postage is more money, or costs you more money than the game itself. Now, next up, arcade conversion time. I remember seeing this in the local sweet shop, and I was blown away by the graphics. Looked incredible. My Sega, that's Thunderblade. Game I had back in the day. Cannot believe it, I haven't picked it up and put it in the collection until now. But yeah, it's one of those games that was developed by Teartex. Teartex games back then tended to have no atmosphere, no music, very minimalistic sound. So think about Street Fighter on Spectrum, 10 guys who made that. It wasn't until like the very late 80s, early 90s they started to put music in their games. Well, Thunderblade kind of deserved to have the atmosphere, didn't it? It looked good on a Spectrum. It played well, I've got to say, for a Spectrum conversion. Getting monochrome as you'd expect. But yeah, I liked it. I just found it hard. I found the arcade version hard as well. I found that difficult. It was made even more difficult by the fact it just had no atmosphere. Cheap and cheerful game, that one. Be careful with US Gold games and Ocean games as well. They either have an instruction pamphlet or leaflet or poster, or they don't. And I always assume they don't, and then forget, and then get a game, which I'll show you in a minute, that came with instructions. So make sure you ask the seller that, because it's very inconsistent. Now, another game I had back in the day. I love this game. The first type of game I played like this, I believe, definitely at home. That game is Micro Pro Soccer. It's the first top-down football game. What I loved about this particular game is the fact you had aftertouch. When you kick the ball, you've got those, like, I think they're called banana shots. That might actually be a real world term. But yeah, I mean, you can do that to the point where the ball will come back to you like a boomerang. Crazy. Two players is brilliant. It's great fun. Against the computer, I'm rubbish. I'll lose every time. But yeah, kind of a precursor to Sensible Soccer. It was designed by Sensible Software, this game. I'm not sure if it was their first outing. I'm pretty sure it was their first big title. And obviously, I was a big Kickoff 2 fan back in the day. So you can see where the inspiration come from, really. Yeah, really good game. Got some great reviews. Again, cheap and cheerful. I'm pretty sure that game, you can either buy it like that or buy it in a big box, from what I remember. Next up is another game I would have played on the Atari ST. It was the best game of its genre that I'd ever played at the time. And that is Lotus SP Turbo Challenge. Converted over to the good old 8 bits. The Spectrum version, you guessed it, it's in monochrome. It plays well, it's quite quick. Not as good as the 16-bit versions, as to be expected. Unfortunately, you get to a point in the road where you have that undulation effect going on. When you get to the apex of the hill, everything else disappears. So yeah, when you come down from the hill, you ain't got a flipping clue where you are. And more than likely, you're going to end up in the side of the flipping road. So that made the game a bit unplayable. Apart from that massive fail, it's not a bad little conversion. Again, not an overly priced game. There wasn't many Gremlin games that came out in boxes like this. That's one of them. Another arcade conversion. I can't remember how I played this originally. It looked familiar to a game. But a game that it might look familiar to is this game. But yeah, I mean... yeah. Game by Data East called Express Raider. Very popular arcade game from what I know of it. I can see now where they got the inspiration for the second level in the Untouchables, the one where you're rolling across the bridge, shooting things. It's identical to that. Or to Express Raider. Exactly the same premise, really. People pop out windows, you shoot them. Sometimes it's an innocent, obviously you don't shoot them. But yeah, I can't remember how I played it originally. It may well have been the Spectrum. I like it, it's a good game, but I reckon it's better on a C64, which I wouldn't mind giving it a go on that machine. I think the Commodore 64 just done games like this better than the Sinclair Spectrum. Again, I think that has got the instructions on the inlay. But yeah, that one there I think was a fiver. But most of these games are relatively cheap. I remember reading Sinclair User one day, seeing the screenshots for this game. I thought it looked fantastic, and Sinclair User had this tendency not to give bad reviews. Generally, most games got 8 out of 10 or more. So that was a bit misleading, really. Especially relevant to this game. And this geezer, I think he grew up not far away from me in Kennington in South London. It's either Kennington or the Oval, one of the two, I can't remember. A long time ago. Just remember seeing a blue plaque on the house. Charlie Chaplin. Yeah, went to America and the rest is history. But this game looked great. Graphics looked good. It looked fun. I mean, I liked Charlie Chaplin when I was a kid. I thought, why not? But yeah, not sure what to do with it. I think you're supposed to do as many silly things as possible, which get you points because you are supposed to be filming a movie. Don't come up very often, this one. And again, you don't often get it complete either. It's got quite a sizable instruction manual in it. But yeah, I'm not sure what to do without reading the instructions. I think it was developed... actually, I don't know. I'm not sure if it's Spanish or French or something. And brought over here then by US Gold. I don't know the origins of the game. I just know it looked good. I fancy playing it. And I'm now disappointed. That's one of the downsides to collecting games. It's when you see screenshots, you think, wow, that's great. And then you actually play it. You think, my God, what have I done? Another arcade conversion. Another US Gold game. Box is an okay nick. That's Dynasty Wars. Again, I found this to be quite bland. I never played this in the arcade. I'm pretty sure I had this on the ST or Amiga. I started out collecting. I never played it. But again, it's one of those games that reminded me a little bit. Well, it didn't really. It's one of those games you ride along for a while, nothing happens, all of a sudden a whole gang turn up, you've got to deal with them. They ride along and nothing happens, a whole gang turn up and deal with them. It got quite repetitive, quite quick. I'm not sure if the Spectrum is a true reflection of the arcade. I can't imagine it is. But again, in monochrome, disappointed that the game cover there's got a little tear. Because this was, I think, an online store pickup. It's got a bit of sun fading to the US Gold logo. I think this might cost me 10, 12 quid, something like that, which I overpaid for. Inside you get a sticker and a tape and a manual. I could certainly do with an upgrade for this, but good to have in the collection. Get one of those lovely Capcom coloured cases, as is the next one. Now this game I quite liked. I've got to say, never played it before. Arcade conversion. Again, probably plays better on the C64. That's Gunsmoke. We see it better there. So yeah, this one was about 10 quid. Again, I think this was developed by a Spanish company. But yeah, I liked it. Vertical scrolling shooter, really, isn't it? Bit like Rambo, Commando, just don't scroll left to right, just go straight up. I'm pretty sure there's certain things you're not supposed to shoot. Looks like there's wanted criminals at the end of each level. I liked it, it's just mindless fun. But again, I haven't played it for enough time to really appreciate it. I certainly recommend that one. Probably why it goes sort of 10 quid. As does the next one. The next one is more of a nostalgia trip, really. As I remember reading CVG magazine, the first one I ever bought, just before I bought Atari ST, just to get some idea of ST games to pick up. This particular magazine had New Zealand Story in it, Vigilante in it, had a game called Squeak, Phobia, and a few others, and this one, which is Chicago 30s, which I picked up a few years ago on the Atari ST, which is very hard to find. It's a game originally done by Toposoft in Spain. Incomplete though, unfortunately, as missing his instructions. Got a very strange, not the game itself's got a strange mechanic, but it's just like the lives is really strange, because it looks like you're looking into a theater. The gameplay isn't, it's just the perspective you see on the screen, and the more action you do, the more people turn up, which I think is some kind of representation of your health or lives. The more you die, the more people piss off and go somewhere else, and then you die. But initially, when you put it on, it's bloody hard. I died so many times, literally a page or a screen and you're dead. Then all of a sudden you kind of get used to it a little bit and you get quite far into it. It's not a bad game, but I think a lot of people would probably get really frustrated by turning it on initially and finding it too difficult. Because I almost never went back to that after that steep learning curve. But yeah, it's all right. But again, I've got that in the collection more for nostalgia more than anything else, really. Okay, the final five. First up is a sealed game. I have very few sealed games in my collection, I've got to say. Not something that I usually go for. This was part of a wider bundle I picked up, must have been a year ago. I've seen it on the Amiga. I've always been intrigued what it's about. And that's Night Hunter. The Amiga version you hardly see. In fact, the Spectrum version you don't often see. This is, again, a £10-15 game. In this condition, probably a little bit more. But it's a strange game. Again, it reminded me a little bit of Alchemist. We changed from Dracula to a bat to a wolf just to try and get around the level, because there's certain pitfalls you need different characters to traverse around, really. So that was interesting. And it reminded me a little bit of the Rocky Horror Show, because it's just got objects placed everywhere you've got to pick up and do stuff with. But I probably played it for about 15 minutes, so it's certainly one of those games I like to go back to, but I like to play it on emulation for the Amiga, just to see what it should really play like. Yeah, but it's good to have it in the collection. It's a nice, quirky game to have, but I just know sod all about it. Then we have a shoot 'em up, Bart Iron, famous for R-Type. This is nothing like R-Type, and in fact, I do like the specky version of this game. Mr. Helly. Yeah, nice Spectrum screenshots on the back there. How colourful they are. But yeah, I played it on the ST, Amiga, okay to play, a bit sluggish. The Spectrum version is really good. I've got to say, it's equally as playable as those two, maybe probably better. It's just in monochrome. But I think it's a well-presented game on the Spectrum. It's certainly quite a desirable one. let's go for sort of 15, 20 quid. It doesn't come up very often for the Spectrum, to be honest. But yeah, I liked it. I actually enjoyed playing that. I played this one for about half an hour. It's weird, isn't it? You've got to shoot certain things to reveal crystals and pick them up and get points. But I quite liked it, I've got to say. Quite quirky. Then next up, we have a game I've been after for ages. Just when it comes up, it sells really quickly. I don't really know why. I know it's a game that a lot of people will remember and like. I don't like it. That's Bruce Lee. I think it looks bloody old for a start, but I'm rubbish at it. That's probably the real reason why I don't like it. Yeah, but what I did like about it, added bonus, I guess, is the fact that it was made in conjunction with Ocean Software. Now, strange, isn't it? Because I think Ocean had a percentage ownership of US Gold. In turn, US Gold, I think, had a certain percentage ownership in Gremlin. So all these great British publishers are probably owned by the same bloody firm, really, or same group of people. Yeah, nice to have it. This was a tenner. Buy it now. It can go for more. I have seen a copy listed recently on the Amstrad on floppy disk for £700, which is slightly expensive. Not even someone as stupid as me would go out and buy that. But yeah, Bruce Lee. Nice to have it. Been after it for ages, but a game I remember from back in the day, but wasn't overly keen on it. It's more one for the collection, really, than to go back and play. My final two games. Next up, we got... Now, I'm not sure if this game was released in the arcade, by the looks of the box. It was released by Tengen. Or Tengen. That's Gauntlet 3. I'm pretty sure Tengen was to do with Atari. So, I'm not sure if Gauntlet 3 got a release in the arcade or not. It may just have their name on it because it's a license. Not really played many Gauntlet games over the years, I've got to say, but I was quite impressed with this one. All isometric. Again, took a little while to get used to navigating around the place, but it literally is Gauntlet in a kind of pseudo 3D environment. And I found it just as bloody difficult. But I do like the first two, and I think a lot of people would prefer the first two to number three. It's got absolutely amazing music by the Folin Brothers. If you like the music from like LED Storm, Sly Spy, Ghouls and Ghosts and stuff like that, yeah, you'll love the music from this. But yeah, I played it for a bit. I actually was quite impressed with that. I know it's quite a desirable title across many formats. I think there's about £10-12 for this, but it can go for about £20. I'm still off the Amiga version, but the Amiga version can go for a lot more. yeah, please have it in the collection. It's actually quite a decent little game. And finally, a game that used to go for a ton back in the day, about 100 quid. It doesn't anymore, for whatever reason. But I remember when it used to collect the first time round, probably pushing 20 years ago. So about 18 years ago, I stopped collecting that particular collection, but this game used to go for about 100 quid. And that's Bubbler, Ultimate Play the Game. I think it's the last Ultimate Play the Game release on the Sinclair Spectrum. Unfortunately, it's another isometric game. And anything with isometric landscapes and balls, I can't cope with it. I tell you, trying to move those balls around so they don't fall off the edge, up like slopes and stuff like that, is a flipping nightmare. It just takes ages to adjust to that isometric control. I just don't like it. I think it's one of the weakest games they've released. I think it got some of the lowest reviews. Yeah, for a long time, along with the compilation, the Collected Works compilation, it's one of the most desirable Ultimate games there was. I think it has been superseded recently by games like Pentagram, which I think do go for a bit more than this now. So yeah, I picked it up for about 40 quid. I'm quite chuffed with the price. I don't know if that's probably now the new going rate for it, 40, 50, 60 quid. But yeah, strange how times change, isn't it, really? Yeah, not an overly difficult game to find, just doesn't come up very often. That's it. That's it for the Sinclair Spectrum pickups. Like I said, got loads more to go through. Which I'm sure I'll get out over the next few weeks and months. So thank you very much for watching this video. Thank you very much for subscribing. I'll see you guys again real soon. Take care and bye for now.